I'm Alex Michaelson. This week, the issue is the price of gas. On yet another record week for high prices, Governor Newsom offers a plan for relief in July. Democrats divided on a path forward. CalMITRE's Alexei Koseff will take us behind the scenes of the negotiations. Plus, Assemblyman Kevin Kiley joins us to lay out the Republican plan and talk about his own run for Congress. Then, the issue is Oscars week, but does anybody care? How does the show recover from record low ratings? Elizabeth Wagmeister of Variety is with us before she co-hosts the National Oscar Pre-Show. The issue is starts right now.
Broadcasting across California, you're watching The Issue Is.
And welcome inside our newsroom, and welcome to The Issue Is. I'm Elex Michaelson, and like you, I'm in disbelief at the price of gas. This week, Governor Gavin Newsom offering up his plan for relief. He wants to give drivers $400 per vehicle in debit cards, up to $800 per person. This would be regardless of your income level.
So today we're announcing a $9 billion tax refund to tens of millions of Californians. That direct relief will address the issue that we all are struggling to address, and that's the issue of gas prices.
He also wants to offer $750 million in incentive grants to make public transportation in California free for the next 3 months. We offered the governor or any member of his team to come on The Issue Is and discuss their plan in depth. They declined that invite. The Republicans accepted our invite. Their plan, pretty simple. An immediate suspension of California's gas excise tax that would save California drivers 51 cents a gallon right now. Democrats have shut down this idea repeatedly in the legislature. Back with us is Kevin Kiley. He currently represents R-Rocklin in the state assembly. Of course, he ran in the recall election for governor. He's currently running for Congress. Kevin Kiley, welcome back to The Issue Is.
Great to be with you, Alex. Thank you.
So let's talk about the gas tax. Democrats say they need that gas tax to stay, to pay for roads and bridges, et cetera. What's your argument of why it needs to go?
Well, to address that right off the bat, that's just totally a red herring, because my bill, which would suspend the gas tax entirely, doesn't cause any loss of funding for roads. That money would be backfilled out of the state's general fund, and we're said to have a $45 billion, maybe as high as $60 billion surplus right now. So I like how you described my bill, our plan, which is it's simple. We simply suspend the state gas tax, and that is the quickest, most meaningful and simplest thing that we could do right now. It's a lever that we as a legislature and the governor could pull where people would immediately see a reduction of about 50 cents in the price of gas. Now, that's not going to make gas prices reasonable by any stretch of the imagination, but would help out a lot of folks in a meaningful way. And it's something that we could do immediately. So it really is mind-boggling that our legislature and our governor are refusing to do that when you have red and blue states across the country that are doing precisely that, cutting their states' much lower gas taxes. Like, for example, in Connecticut, the legislature just unanimously passed a gas tax suspension bill, and the liberal governor, Ned Lamont, signed it into law.
Of course, Democrats here in California have supermajorities in the Assembly and in the Senate. So basically, they can do whatever they want, and you basically can be shut down every time you try. So what is the strategy for when you don't have the votes to get something like this through?
Well, the strategy is what we've been doing. We're forcing the issue, and we're forcing people to go on the record. And we have indeed produced results, because this big rebate plan that the governor just announced followed a plan put forth by various members of the legislature, which only became a reality. You see pictures of it right there on the screen after we forced them to vote on the gas tax suspension. So what happened was we brought this bill to the floor of the assembly. We forced a vote on it. And the members who voted against it heard from their constituents, who were sort of in disbelief. How could you not vote to suspend the gas tax right now when gas is reaching $6 a gallon? And so these rebate plans that you're seeing are really a way to sort of deflect from their unwillingness to suspend the gas tax. And by the way, I'm all for doing tax rebates. I think that tax relief is a good thing. It should be pretty much automatic when there's a surplus. You return the money to the folks that you got it from. But that is an entirely separate question. How do we address the specific problem of outrageous gas prices? And I've proposed a specific solution, which is to suspend our very high state gas tax.
All right. Well, we know that it's highly unlikely that Republicans will end up with a majority in Sacramento next year, but they could very well have a majority in Washington next year. You are running for Congress. What would you see as your role in D.C. and why the decision to leave Sacramento for D.C.?
Yeah, it was a hard decision for me because I've been fighting the battles in our legislature for the last 5 years, and I've been fighting to get California on the right track and to, you know, try to turn our state around. I think this is the greatest state in the country, but unfortunately, failed policies are ruining the experience of living in California for many people, to the point where you now have even the most liberal city in maybe the country, San Francisco, that's recalling its school board members, that's recalling its district attorney. People can see that the quality of life here is deteriorating because of failed policy choices. And what I see happening is those same failures are now in many ways going national. Our country is starting to repeat the same mistakes as our state. Gavin Newsom has said that California is a model for the nation. And I want to make it very clear that no, California is a warning to the nation of what happens when corrupt and radical policies carry the day. And I want to try to lead sort of, the movement to return our state and our country to the founding principles that have made this the greatest country in the world.
All right, well, Assemblyman Kiley, it's always great to see you. Good luck on the campaign trail, and thanks for coming on The Issue Is.
You bet. Thanks, Alex.
More now on gas prices. While Republicans are united on a plan, Democrats are divided. Let's discuss all of it with Alexei Koseff. He's a reporter with CalMatters. Before that, he was with the San Francisco Chronicle and Sacramento Bee. He currently serves as president of the Sacramento Press Club. And by the way, he broke that story of Governor Newsom having dinner at the French Laundry. Did you hear about that one? That, of course, changed the course of our state's political history. Alexei, welcome back to The Issue Is. Good to have you with us. Let's lay the states out here. Remember, this is a reminder. Governor Newsom wants to give $400 to every registered car owner, up to $800. It doesn't matter how much money you have. But the legislative leaders who are Democrats want something else. They want to give $200 per person with an additional $200 for your dependent. They only want those benefits going to people making less than $250,000. Everybody else would get nothing back. So let's talk about that now, Alexei. You've got this back and forth between the governor and the top Democrats. What's really happening behind the scenes right now?
You know, to be honest, not a lot. Normally, you'd be having these kind of opening bids for what each side might be willing or want to do happening behind the scenes. Now it's sort of been thrust into the public by this political situation. But the reality is that we're still in the very early stages. There are not even real conversations that are happening yet between the legislature and the governor. And so what you're seeing is everybody sort of laying out the stakes of what it is they want and a little bit of back and forth that's happening through the press about where there might be details where they could come to a compromise.
It seems like a big difference, though, is on that issue of who should get the money, whether rich people should get a check or not.
Absolutely. I mean, I think this is the fundamental question that's going to need to be solved, is who gets the money and how do you get it to them? Because the reality is they're going to be wanting to give that money to the people who need it most. If a bunch of the money ends up going to very wealthy people, even millionaires, it's just going to come back at them as an attack ad. So you're seeing some of that angst playing out in these various proposals and this back and forth that's happening with the governor and the legislative leaders.
Of course, the reason that California's surplus is so big is that so many rich people made so much money that they paid so much money back in taxes. And they basically have to give some of that money back, right? I mean, in the most simple terms, California has this thing called the GAN limit. Can you explain that so an average person that isn't sitting in legislative hearings all day understands what that means for them?
Sure. So basically, there's a certain amount of money per person in California that the state is allowed to spend. And once you go above that amount, that money either has to be put into infrastructure projects or it has to go back to people as some kind of tax rebate. And we won't know exactly how much money the state has to give back until a few more months from now when all of the tax returns come in, but we're expecting it's probably going to be billions of dollars. And so the reality is that this gas rebate is the type of proposal that could fulfill that constitutional requirement to give some of that money back to taxpayers.
Yeah, so essentially, they have to give money back anyways. Why not call it a gas tax rebate instead of calling it a stimulus at the time of inflation, right? And it checks that box without losing the money that they get for gas taxes, which is what Republicans want them to do.
Right. The complicated part is that you know, by going this route with the rebate, it gives them a little bit more control over how the money goes back. You know, they're not just handing everybody back, you know, a couple of dollars. They're trying to direct more money in a higher amount that really might make a difference toward the neediest people. And they wouldn't have necessarily the flexibility to do it that way if they tried some of these other types of proposals.
Look, we know that this gas prices issue affects everybody in a big way. We also know there are issues like crime and homelessness that Governor Newsom is underwater on right now, not getting great results. And yet he's not facing too much of a competition when it comes to re-election. Certainly, you don't get the sense that his team is sweating this re-election campaign, do you?
I don't get the sense that anybody is really sweating this re-election campaign. Obviously, it's, you know, foolish to say 7 to 8 months out what the outcome is going to be, but we've yet to see any of the few Republicans who are running against him, you know, gain any kind of traction. They're certainly starting from a place of having barely any name recognition. The pressure, though, is certainly mounting on legislators, who, many of whom face their own more competitive races in their districts. And if they don't act swiftly, then there could be repercussions for them and the Democratic majority in Sacramento.
Yeah, I mean, you think about waiting until July, which is what the governor suggested, while people are paying $6 gas now. That may be hard to stomach politically. All right, that's the serious issues. You know, Alexei, we like to dance on this show. And most of us that dance on the show, like me, are terrible dancers, but we have fun with it. You're actually a real dancer. We've got a clip of you dancing to a song called Malamente. I mean, look at these moves. This guy's really got it. We need to see you on Dancing with the Stars at some point. I think you would win that. Look at that spin move. So we want to end with this.
What you doing?
Getting mixed up with her.
Netflix's Power of the Dog is nominated for 12 Oscars, the most of any film. Of course, entertainment is one of California's signature industries, but TV ratings for the Oscars have been slipping for years, and this year, the Academy is making some big changes. After several years of no hosts, this year there will be three. Amy Schumer, Regina Hall, Wanda Sykes will each take turns hosting for an hour each. The presenters are coming from a variety of industries. Snowboarder and skateboarder Shaun White is among those presenting. So is Kelly Slater, who is surfing royalty, of course, but not exactly known for his film history. Let's talk about it all with Elizabeth Wagmeister. She's chief correspondent at Variety, co-host of The Take. And this weekend, she's once again a part of ABC's official Oscars pre-show broadcast. Elizabeth, congratulations on that, and welcome back to The Issue Is.
Thank you, Alex. I always love joining you, and congratulations to you and your entire team on the show.
Thank you very much. Okay, you know that I love the Oscars. I cover them for years. I watch all the movies. And I totally forgot they were this week, which to me is like a bad sign for the industry. I know I'm not alone in not being as excited as I have been in years past. Do you think the Academy believes that it has a watchability problem when it comes to the show?
I don't think the Academy would be too happy to hear, Alex, that you forgot that the Oscars were this weekend. But I think that that answers the question perfectly. There is definitely a watchability problem. Last year, now, let's also keep in mind, it was during the pandemic and the rough part of the pandemic. But last year, there was just over 10 million viewers. 10 million viewers for the biggest night in Hollywood? I mean, that's nothing. And to put this into perspective, the year prior, just 1 year before that, there were over 23 million. And that, Alex, was a record low. So this shows you the steep decline, more than 50% loss in viewership. But this year, I've got to tell you, the producers, they're really trying to amp up the entertainment value. They have Beyonce performing. They have Billie Eilish. You have A-listers from Kristen Stewart to Will Smith. And you also have an award that's being voted on Twitter. So they clearly recognize this watchability issue, and they're doing everything they can to excite viewers.
But is there a fundamental problem in the movies that are nominated themselves? They are not nominating big box office successful movies. Is that part of the problem?
Absolutely. And I think that this year you are getting some films that are a bit more mainstream, even to years past, particularly when you look at the stars that are in them. You know, I mentioned Will Smith, Kristen Stewart. If you look at some of the top categories, you have people like Andrew Garfield and Benedict Cumberbatch, Jessica Chastain, Penelope Cruz, Nicole Kidman. These are big names that people theoretically should be coming to tune in for. But you're absolutely right that these mainstream films, the ones that have really brought people back to theaters after the pandemic, things like The Batman, like Spider-Man, all these big films. I mean, I think a lot of people were hoping that, I mentioned Andrew Garfield, that Spider-Man would be nominated, but he's nominated for a film that I loved called Tick, Tick, Boom. But even though it's on Netflix, ready to stream right there, a lot of people have never heard of that.
Right, exactly. Spider-Man, one of the biggest movies of all time. So you mentioned Netflix. The way people watch movies is different now. That was already going to happen. It was really sped up by the pandemic, the idea of streaming. This year, we will likely have our first Best Picture winner from a streaming service. What do you think is the significance of that for Hollywood's entire business model, which is a big part of California's business model?
Absolutely. I mean, you're living under a rock if you don't know that it's all about streaming. Of course, streaming is really synonymous with Netflix, but of course, there's Amazon, there's Apple, there's Hulu, and now every single major media conglomerate has their own streaming service, and they're really trying to strike big with it. Now, what's interesting is this year, it's going to be a race to the finish between Netflix and Apple. Apple has a film called Coda, which happens to be my favorite film of award season. And Netflix, as you mentioned, Power of the Dog, which leads the nomination with 12, that is right up there for Best Picture. So a lot of industry experts think it is neck and neck between those two, although some are predicting Belfast. I don't think it's going to go to Belfast. But what's interesting, Alex, is Netflix has been campaigning like crazy for years. We all remember there was Roma, then there was The Irishman, and they lost. They have not won Best Picture. No streaming service has. So the fact that it very possibly could go to Apple, this is going to be World War III in the hallways of Netflix.
Up next, we're going to get your expert pick on who's going to win to help everybody with their Oscar pools. But first, music from my favorite movie of the year as well, Coda.
I need to get by.
Oscar night is the ultimate Hollywood night, a look at the Dolby Theater in Hollywood, where our next guest this week will once again be reporting from the red carpet. Elizabeth Wagmeister is back. She's one of ABC's Oscar night hosts and one of the top experts in the country on Oscars. Elizabeth, good to see you. We want to get your picks so that everybody watching this can show up their friends with those Oscar pools and get everything right, right? We want to win everybody money. So let's go through
no
the categories.
At all.
No pressure. Vegas is listening to you right now. Okay, so who's going to win Best Picture?
I am going with Coda. You and I both just said it is our favorite film of award season. That's my pick. I think Apple's winning.
Best Director.
Best Director, I do believe, will go to Jane Campion for Power of the Dog. However, we all know she had that recent slip-up, that controversy with Venus and Serena. If she doesn't win, I believe it's because Oscar voters are upset about that.
Speaking of Venus and Serena, Best Actor, you say Will Smith for making the movie about Venus and Serena's dad.
Yes, I think this is Will Smith's night. Do you realize, Alex, Will Smith has never won an Oscar? How is that possible? I think that will all change this Sunday.
In terms of Best Actress, your pick, Jessica Chastain?
Yes, I do think Jessica Chastain, but I also think this race is probably the one where we could see a surprise. It's really just stacked with A-listers.
Best supporting actor, you say history is about to happen.
Yes, Troy Kotsur, who is one of the stars of Coda, I believe that he will win, which would make him the second deaf actor to win in Oscars history. And fun fact, the first deaf actor to win was his Coda co-star, Marlee Matlin, decades ago.
And finally, best supporting actress.
I think this is going to Ariana DeBose from West Side Story. We all heard the big controversy this week with her co-star, Rachel Zegler, who wasn't nominated, but she will now be there as a presenter after saying that she was not originally invited. But I think Ariana is taking away the gold.
I think you could see an upset for Best Director, speaking of West Side Story. Steven Spielberg may be able to sneak through.
I wouldn't be surprised. And if that happens, we're going to talk after, because then I have to give you some cred, Alex.
All right. Elizabeth, good luck at the Oscars. You can watch her on ABC Oscar Night. More of The Issue is after this. But we go to break with Elizabeth, your pick for Best Song. It's from Encanto. Welcome to the Los Angeles mayoral debate. This week, I was honored to co-moderate the Fox 11 LA Times USC debate and the LA mayor's race. It was one of the highlights of my career. You can watch the full thing right now at youtube.com/Fox11Los Angeles. We end this week on The Issue Is with nature. The official beginning of spring this week, the Above Los Angeles Instagram account traveled across the state to check out some incredible flower displays, including this one in Carlsbad. We're all feeling a little brand new with the new season. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next week.